Okay. The next item of business is a debate on motion 11696 in the name of Shirley-Ann Somerville on From a Warm Scots Welcome to a Warm Scots Future for Ukrainians in Scotland. And invite members wishing to take part in the debate to press the request to speak buttons. And I invite Shirley-Ann Somerville to speak to and move the motion. Cabinet Secretary, around 10 minutes, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I'm very pleased to move the motion in my name to support once again Ukraine and the delivery of a warm Scots future for its people here in Scotland. As 2023 draws to a close, it is, of course, with great sadness that despite it being a time of year where we might expect to pay homage to fraternity and peace, so many people around the world continue to experience war and violent conflict, and so many people will be apart from their family and loved ones this year. We have all been shocked and horrified by the conflict in Gaza and Israel, but we must also remember that it has now been nearly 2 years since the Russian state's full invasion of Ukraine began in February 2022. The United Nations has reported that civilian casualties in Ukraine since the start of Russia's full-scale invasion has reached nearly 30,000. Let me be clear once again that this government condemns Russia's illegal war and offers its unqualified support for Ukrainian sovereignty, independence and territorial integrity. This solidarity extends to the Ukrainian people, to those who remain in Ukraine and to the many who have now made Scotland their home. This partnership between the people of Scotland and of Ukraine remains as strong today as it was at the outset of Russia's full-scale invasion, and that is why it is so important that Scotland's Parliament reinforces that solidarity in the debate this afternoon and through supporting this motion. At the outset of the war, the Scottish Government, keen to ensure Scotland played its role as a good global citizen, welcomed the UK's decision to establish the Homes for Ukraine scheme to enable Ukrainian nationals and their family members to come to the UK. In order to enable applicants to travel promptly and to eliminate the need for individuals escaping conflict to actively search for sponsors, the Scottish Government opted to act as a sponsor in its own right, and we created the Scottish Super Sponsor Scheme, an accessible and secure approach for displaced people from Ukraine to travel to Scotland and the UK. I want to take the opportunity once again to sincerely thank all of those who have opened their hearts and their homes to displaced Ukrainians fleeing war. The success of the Super Sponsor Scheme and its wider efforts to support displaced people within our communities could not have been achieved without the overwhelming generosity of our constituents, the length and breadth of the nation. Since the invasion began, almost 26,300 people, sponsored by an individual in Scotland or the Scottish Government, have arrived in the UK. These figures translate to Scotland having offered sanctuary to more displaced people from Ukraine per head of population than any other part of the UK. However, it must be said that the people of Scotland have gone beyond offering our new friends from Ukraine somewhere to live. They have worked together alongside government partners, local authorities, charities and third sector bodies to offer displaced people a real home and a place of belonging within our communities. The Scottish Government is investing over £100 million in 23-24 as part of the Ukrainian resettlement programme to ensure people continue to receive a warm Scots welcome and are supported to rebuild their lives in our communities for as long as they want to call Scotland their home. This builds on the significant funding provided in 22-23 to support our resettlement programme. We have used this funding, working with our partners in local government and across civic society, to provide a place of sanctuary for our new friends and neighbours from Ukraine that supports them to integrate fully into Scotland. And, Presiding Officer, I would like to note at this point and take the time to congratulate everyone involved, particularly in Edinburgh's Warm Scots Welcome, a multi-agency response to the displacement of Ukrainian refugees, on winning the Voluntary Sector Partnership Award. And I'd also like to congratulate all the staff working in the Scottish Government Ukraine Directorate for the work that has gone on this year. And it is fitting that at the recent Civil Service Awards, they won the winner of Excellence in Delivery Awards. Presiding Officer, there are many fine civil servants in the Scottish Government, and Ukraine colleagues are certainly amongst the best, and I am proud to work with them. On the issue of further support that we can and will continue to provide, on employment and the cost of living, displaced people from Ukraine have the right to work in the UK from day one of arrival and to apply for social security support. The Scottish Government has worked closely with Skills Development Scotland, the Department of Work and Pensions, the third sector and local authorities to ensure displaced Ukrainians in Scotland are able to access relevant and appropriate employment, training and social security support. Local authority teams and employment partnerships are active in every council area, offering bespoke and tailored advice to help displaced people take advantage of the opportunities to engage in economic activity and to immerse themselves in our societies. Those opportunities also hold the potential for being a real opportunity for Scotland too, with analysis published by this government in March highlighting the tangible benefit migration and displaced people from Ukraine can have on the Scottish economy. Beyond economic opportunities, the Scottish Government has always been clear that our friends from Ukraine should be able to access the full array of public services and the elements of life available to everyone in Scotland. This includes the right to access NHS healthcare services, entitlement to primary and secondary education, and the free tuition and cost of living support available to students already resident in Scotland. To list all the services and opportunities available would take a long time, indeed, because they are in fact the same services and opportunities we work with our partners to provide to all people living in Scotland. And I want to take this opportunity to also thank the many organisations and volunteers who have offered so much to help displaced Ukrainians access these services and opportunities. Alongside this, however, the Scottish Government has taken bespoke measures in an array of areas to help displaced people settle into life in Scotland. And that's why we're working to ensure displaced people do not have to stay in short-term accommodation for longer than necessary. And we're working intensively with our local authority and third sector partners to support everyone into longer-term housing. One example of our efforts in this area is the £50 million Ukraine Longer Term Resettlement Fund, a fund aimed at bringing local authority and registered social landlord empty properties back into use that would otherwise not have been available for let. I'm delighted to confirm to date that a total of 16 capital projects providing 1,201 homes have so far received commitments to fund improvement works through the fund at a cost of around £24 million. That's delivering strong value for money and in many cases providing a longer-term legacy of social housing for Scotland. It is to the longer-term legacy of our Ukraine resettlement programme that I now turn, Presiding Officer, and whilst the Scottish Government wishes, of course, a speedy victory for Ukraine in the current conflict, the legacy of Scotland's efforts to integrate the people of Ukraine with our communities is one we wish to be lasting. That is why the next phase of our response to support those from Ukraine is part of our vision to provide a warm Scots future, which offers Scotland's support over the longer term. In light of this, the Government published its Warm Scots Future Policy Position Paper in September, a document that sets out our five strategic priorities that will help ensure those from Ukraine can play active roles in communities across Scotland and fulfil their potential in work and education. Beyond a continued focus on the delivery of longer-term housing, as I have already outlined, our Warm Scots Future strategic priorities include a holistic and rights-based approach to longer-term integration, in line with our New Scots Refugee Integration Strategy. This approach will ensure a concerted effort to not only support the immediate needs of displaced people, but to empower them to regain their autonomy and reduce the vulnerabilities induced by displacement. The upcoming English for Speakers of Other Languages review, as part of the Adult Learning Strategy, will be utilised to ensure the unique experiences of displaced people from Ukraine in this area are acknowledged and addressed. Furthermore, perhaps most significantly, our holistic approach to enabling displaced people to engage in healthcare, education, employment and within our communities aligns with the National Trauma Training Programme and the Mental Health and Wellbeing Strategy. This will make sure we take into account the specific circumstances of each individual's health, but also the impact that war and the experience of displacement has had on them. One of our other key strategic priorities in delivering a Warm Scots Future will be to pursue clarity on routes to settlement, family reunification and repatriation. We have been clear that we want displaced people from Ukraine to be able to make Scotland their home for as long as they need us. But with immigration reserved, we are pressing the UK Government for clarity on what will happen as the initial three-year period for homes for Ukraine visas comes to an end in March 2025. Displaced people from Ukraine must not be at risk of becoming destitute if they are unable to return safely to Ukraine after their visa expires. And urgent clarity is needed for Ukrainians on what their options may be so that they can make informed decisions about where they want to live. We recognise that many displaced people from Ukraine may opt for voluntary repatriation when it is safe for them to return to Ukraine, and we are clear about the need for there to be support in place for people to do so. However, in line with our commitment to deliver a warm Scots future, clarity on visas is also essential to help us to effectively work with our partners across Scotland to plan for ongoing integration and to ensure Scotland can offer the life chances and opportunities that will help our new Scots fully embrace their roles in our communities. Whilst we press the UK Government for certainty over visas, we will continue to work with stakeholders to ensure that the lived experience of those already in our communities is taken into account. Presiding Officer, in conclusion, this motion before us this afternoon provides this Parliament with an opportunity to restate its unwavering commitment to Ukraine and an opportunity for us to once again reaffirm that those from Ukraine are welcome here. The new cross-party group on Ukraine, which I had the pleasure of attending the inaugural meeting to, was another good example of that support. We will be there for those from Ukraine now and into the future, after victory, as they continue to rebuild Ukraine, whether that's in our links with our universities or businesses. And I sincerely hope that this Parliament will take the opportunity to make clear again our firm commitment to Ukraine, and will continue to do so in the months and years ahead. Thank you.
Thank you. Could you move the motion, please?
I move the motion, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. A gentle reminder to those who haven't already pressed the request to speak buttons but intend to speak in the debate to do so now or as soon as possible. And I call on Miles Briggs to speak to and move Amendment 11696.2, around 7 minutes. Mr Briggs.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And I do welcome today's debate and the opportunity, as the Cabinet Secretary have said already, for Parliament to reaffirm in the strongest possible terms our solidarity with the people and government of Ukraine. Since President Putin and the Russian military launched its full-scale armed attack against Ukraine on the 24th of February 2022, the United Nations Human Rights Monitoring Mission in Ukraine has estimated that at least 10,000 civilians, including more than 360 children, have been killed and over 18,500 have been injured. And as we prepare for Christmas and think about a peaceful time here in Scotland across the UK, I want to take this opportunity to acknowledge just the scale of horror being faced by men and women and children in Ukraine at this moment. It's estimated that around a quarter of civilian casualties have occurred not on the front line, but from attacks with missiles and loitering munitions predominantly launched by the Russian armed forces. In the deadliest such attack this year, a missile launched by Russian armed forces struck a funeral reception in Horoza village in Kharkiv Oblast on the 5th of October, killing 59 civilians in total violation of international humanitarian law. The attack, although more lethal, aligns with a pattern of several attacks we have seen where powerful missiles are striking populated areas under the control of Ukraine, resulting in multiple civilian casualties and significant damage to civilian property and infrastructure. And it's been estimated as well that the number of Ukrainian and Russian troops killed or wounded since the war began is now nearing over 500,000 as well. The situation in Ukraine remains appalling, and the brutality that has been visited on its people defies belief. But what is important is that we make sure we stand with the people of Ukraine and also make sure that their concerns are heard in our Parliament today. Other humanitarian concerns taking place in other parts of the world at this moment in time must not detract from the situation we see in Ukraine or diminish from our complete support for their government and country. And I am proud of the fact that from the outset, the United Kingdom has stood shoulder to shoulder with Ukraine and has been at the forefront of helping the Ukrainian people and its government. We were and continue to be one of the main countries to provide military equipment and training after Russia seized Crimea, and have supported Ukraine throughout the build-up to this war as they've tried to resist the invasion. So it is vital that we continue to provide that support for as long as it takes. Deputy Presiding Officer, as I've stated, the human impact of this war is stark. Around 6 million people have been displaced from Ukraine, and a record 6 million across Europe. 5.1 million are displaced in the country itself as well. In Poland, we have seen the highest number of people cross the border from Ukraine, around 13 million. And Russia is also hosting around 1.3 million people, with Germany around 1.1 million. And as has been mentioned, the United Kingdom has also made sure that we've offered sanctuary, with 209,000 people displaced from Ukraine here in the UK. I think the Scottish Government's latest statistics suggest around 26,000 of those are here with sanctuary in Scotland. And we have stepped up across our public services to provide that in all our communities. And I want to, as the Cabinet Secretary has, pay specific tribute to those who have put in that work across our local government. And perhaps here in Edinburgh, and I know Edinburgh members who from the outset have undertaken visits to various schools and also to the ship when it was down in Leith, have seen that in action. But I especially want to pay tribute to the schools who have supported young people. And I know one of the lasting legacies of this conflict will actually be the friendships which have been forged between Ukrainian children and Scottish children, and that will last forever. Councils have been working closely with their partners across the public and voluntary sector and community sector to provide that support. And I want to make sure that they are highlighted in today's debate as well, because it has been a community uprising as well to provide that support. There's so many people often not taking the support which government is offering, but actually communities raising those funds and making sure individuals are supported, and that's something we should acknowledge. As my amendment for today's debate makes reference, though, there are some specific concerns being expressed by charities and organisations with regards to the housing issues being faced by many displaced Ukrainians and Scots currently placed in temporary accommodation. Finding sustainable solutions to that problem is critical, as other debates around this issue have highlighted. And I hope the consensus which the Cabinet Secretary has asked for today will mean that all the motions for today's debate will be supported cross-party, because I think it is important we do register in this debate that the housing element is something we need to still continue to focus on for both Ukrainians and Scots who are in temporary accommodation at this time. As the Cabinet Secretary has said, there remains a really important recognition of the work which local support groups, the length and breadth of the country, are undertaking. And I want to also, as the Cabinet Secretary has said, put on record the fact that the Scottish Parliament has finally established a cross-party group on Ukraine. I think that first meeting, for those of us who were at it, really saw the passion of those who were involved. And I was very much taken by the other consulate generals who attended at that event and their full support for Ukraine as well. So I welcome the establishment of the cross-party group, and I'm not sure if Colin Beattie is speaking in the debate today or not, but put on record my tribute to him for helping as a catalyst for that to take place. Colin Beattie, Paul O'Kane, Alex Cole-Hamilton, myself will co-chair that cross-party group, but I hope other members across the Parliament will look to join that cross-party group. It will be, I hope, an opportunity as we move forward for how long this war will continue to give Parliament an opportunity to really hear concerns and the voices of people from Ukraine living in Scotland at the heart of the Parliament. Finally, Deputy Presiding Officer, to close, the people of Ukraine are not only fighting for their freedom, but they are fighting for the cause of freedom, and we must make sure that they prevail. I hope today's debate, just before Christmas, has given Parliament the opportunity once again to put on record our full-hearted support for the people of Ukraine and their government, and the sanctuary Scotland will continue to offer, and I move the amendment in my name. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr Briggs. I now call Paul O'Kane to speak to and move Amendment 11696.1, around 5 minutes. Mr O'Kane.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer, and I will move the amendment in my name. It has been 663 days since the full-scale invasion of Ukraine on the 24th of February 2022, and it has been 3,589 days since Ukraine's sovereignty was first violated during the illegal annexation of Crimea on the 20th of February 2014. It remains now, as it was then, an unacceptable and despicable act to launch such aggression on the European continent for the first time in many of our lifetimes. And it remains now vital, as it was then, to stand side by side with the people of Ukraine, to provide them with the support that they need, both those who have remained in Ukraine and those who have had no alternative but to flee from Ukraine and to seek refuge elsewhere in the world. Indeed, as we've heard already in this debate this afternoon, we have welcomed into this country those who were fleeing bombs, artillery and missiles. And in doing so, that was the very least we could do to demonstrate our firm solidarity with the Ukrainian people. And we must continue to do that and to offer that sense of welcome for as long as it remains unsafe and people are unable to return home. Those people should know that the option of a home in the United Kingdom and here in Scotland is a safe place available to them with all of the support that they would need. I think in this debate as well, Deputy Presiding Officer, we've heard about the important initiatives that have been carried out in Parliament over that time period I outlined. And certainly I would like to add my voice to colleagues from across the chamber about the strength of the cross-party group on Ukraine, having been established just this month indeed, in the Parliament. And I hope that it will be a strong vehicle for all of us across the Parliament to be able to offer that solidarity and support to the people of Ukraine. The move by the Scottish Government to establish longer-term support for Ukrainians in Scotland beyond the emergency phase is correct and necessary. It is incumbent, I think, now on the Government to ensure that the voices of Ukrainians in Scotland are listened to when constructing and implementing that support, and ensuring that the programme of work is carried forward at pace with all of the appropriate resourcing we would want to see. The amendment in my name notes and seeks to add to the Government's motion. We welcome and applaud all ordinary Scots who have welcomed Ukrainian refugees into their homes. I think that's a really important point to put on record in this debate and through the amendment today, because when the call for help arose, people across this country answered it and demonstrated, I think, the very best of us, and their ongoing support should never be forgotten. In this chamber or elsewhere in Scotland, because it was the ordinary people of Scotland who, as I say, rose to that call and brought people into their homes. As we move to a longer-term strategy to support those Ukrainians who have come to Scotland as a result of the invasion, it is important, I think, that we do face up to and solve many of the challenges that are in front of that strategy. And we've already heard reference from Miles Briggs to housing being one of the bigger challenges that we know exist. There is a housing emergency in Scotland, and we also know that research conducted for the British Red Cross by Heriot Watt University has shown that Ukrainians are four times more likely to face homelessness than the wider population. And that sits on top of previous research from the British Red Cross published back in March that showed that many Ukrainian refugees were living in inappropriate accommodation. Yes?
Keith Brown.
Thank Paul O'Kane for taking the intervention. And just in the interest of a more rounded debate, would he acknowledge that some of the issues with housing are, first, that the UK took so long to open its borders in the first place, that they have withdrawn the local government's resettlement fund tariff, which is available to help local authorities do that, and also that Scotland's taken nearly 20% of all Ukrainians. So would that not add some pressure to the housing situation in Scotland?
Paul O'Kane, I can give you the time back.
I'm very grateful, Deputy Presiding Officer, and I thank Keith Brown for his intervention. I wouldn't deny much of what Mr Brown has said in terms of the challenges there have been with UK support and ensuring that that support is available, particularly to local authorities across the country, in a more sustainable way. But I am coming on to discuss the fact that we do have long-standing structural problems in terms of housing in Scotland, and I think that is compounding the opportunities and the options for local authorities to be able to provide housing more generally to those who come to our shores seeking asylum and indeed seeking refuge. So whilst notwithstanding I accept some of those points, I think there is a wider point here, and the wider point of course being that much of the money that has been passed down from some of those funds is not ring-fenced, and although I appreciate that ring-fencing is not something government would seek to do, it does mean that local authorities who are already stretched are having to spread that money more thinly and ensure that they can provide more housing options across all of their estate, if you like, in terms of local authorities. So I do think there are significant challenges. I think today's budget we will need to reflect upon. Certainly, initial analysis shows a 32% reduction in the housing budget. We're going to have a very serious conversation about that in this context and in the broader context I refer to in reply to Keith Brown. I'm conscious, Presiding Officer, of time and indeed of the consensual nature of this debate, which I do think is vitally important. Consideration must be given also to education, healthcare and other services which allow people from Ukraine living here in Scotland to have access as to normal life as possible. So we as a Parliament need to ensure that we reaffirm our supportive and welcoming attitudes to those fleeing war, violence and persecution, that we ensure that we stand full square with Ukraine against Russian aggression, and that we advance as a Parliament our warm welcome by putting in place all of the structures and support that is required to make that a genuinely deliverable outcome. I'm very grateful.
Thank you, Mr. O'Kane. I now call Alex Cole-Hamilton around 4 minutes, please.
Thank you very much indeed, Presiding Officer. Can I start by declaring my interest, having been a sponsor or a host under the Homes for Ukraine scheme for 9 months, and also under official sanction by the Russian Federation. Can I thank the government for bringing today's debate? This is a really important one. The Cabinet Secretary said, and I think in a very excellent speech at the start, that there is a tight competition for the worst place in the world right now. She rightly mentioned Gaza. But right up there would be the east bank of the Dnipro River, where right now the fighting men and women of Ukraine have established a tiny bridgehead from which they hope to launch a full-on counter-offensive. And we wish them well in that regard, because the fighting men and women of Ukraine are not just fighting for their own sovereignty, but they are for the free democracies and the principal democracies of the entire world. As we today remember the refugees that we have opened our homes to, it's important, I think, to remember the war that they are fleeing from, because the West, I think, is in real danger of combat fatigue. And we see that no more clearly in the debates in the House of Representatives in America about the cessation of funding there. Almost exactly 1 year ago today, I was visited by a combat veteran of the Armed Forces of Ukraine, and he gave to me, I think, one of the best Christmas presents I've ever had, which was actually a set of combat insignia patches from his regiment in the Armed Forces of Ukraine. And he'd done that because my constituency staff and I had helped him and his disabled wife get a council accommodation in the city. He had been living for several months in the Hilton Doubletree at the airport, but he himself had an acquired brain injury, having been blown off a tank in the early days of the war. His story, I think, was really important to my team in terms of the swiftness with which we were able to help him and the speed at which local services wrapped around him. He followed the journey that many do, right into the heart of my constituency. West Edinburgh was, of course, the principal point of ingress for our Ukrainian guests, with many of them arriving at City of Edinburgh International Airport. There, they were met by volunteers at the Ukrainian Welcome Desk. Not many of the volunteers spoke Ukrainian, but they soon learned enough to make people feel immediately welcome. Onwards, they were embarked to Gogobone House, where I know a number of my Edinburgh colleagues have visited the Ukrainian Welcome Hub there, where people like Alistair and Gavin would make them feel welcome. So much so that a baby who was born in that house was actually named Alistair after one of the City of Edinburgh Council workers that had made them to feel so welcome. And I know that my experience of being a host, and there are several other MSPs, some sitting in this chamber who are hosts themselves, will attest to the fact that that experience has been life-enriching in ways that we could not have imagined, that it has brought cultures together, but also lifelong friends. And I look forward to welcoming Alina, who is our guest for 9 months, back to our Christmas table on Christmas Day. Presiding Officer, across Scotland, thousands of people have opened their homes to refugees in this way. And I was full of admiration and for the ambition of the Scottish Government's super sponsorship scheme and the warmth of the hospitality that so many Scots have shown them in the face of that terrible, oppressive invasion. But I wish we could offer room for more, but we know that capacity has been at full stretch, evidenced, as Miles Briggs rightly said, by the need to deploy the cruise ship in the Port of Leith for the best part of a year. In July, just this year, we knew that 1 in 10 Ukrainians were still stuck in temporary accommodation. That's not the new life, I think, that they would have hoped of Scotland as they travelled across Europe with a visa and a dream of home. I want to turn specifically to the point of transport, because actually I think that has been problematic in finding homes for our Ukrainian guests. I have long called for the free bus travel scheme to be extended to anyone who's here on a refugee scheme, but particularly given the needs of our Ukrainian guests. In the programme for government last year, the First Minister promised to work with third sector partners and local authorities to consider how best to provide free bus travel to asylum seekers and refugees, including displaced people from Ukraine. And in October this year, Patrick Harvey said he would seek to make free bus travel available to people seeking asylum in Scotland. Yet, there's still nothing concrete in place. Today's budget was room for just one mention of the scheme, but again, nothing black and white. So I hope that in her closing remarks, the Cabinet Secretary might make reference to where the government is on this, because I think that's really important for their settlement. Finally, if I may, Presiding Officer, I'll finish where I started, on the east bank of the Dnieper. All of us who enjoy the comfort and freedom that democracy brings owe those fighting men and women a debt we will never be able to repay. Slava Ukraini.
Thank you. We now move to the open debate. I call first Keith Brown, to be followed by Sharon Dowie. Around 4 minutes, Mr Brown.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It's 2 years, as has been mentioned, since the invasion began, and much of the talk about the invasion in the media now, particularly in the light of other world events, is about war fatigue, the idea that public willingness to support Ukraine in the West is somehow beginning to slow down. And I hope that's not the case, and today is a chance for us to show that here in Scotland that's not the case. We need to show that we want to reiterate our commitment as a nation to supporting the independence of Ukraine, firstly on its own merits, but also in order to protect human life. And it's absolutely right that this motion states that clearly. And just to say, in relation to unity and consensus, I regret the fact there are comments in the amendments which are critical of the situation, given the points I've made in terms of how slow the UK was to open its borders, the fact that support's been taken away from local authorities, and the fact that Scotland's managed to accommodate around 20% of all Ukrainians. And I think if we're going to try and make wider points, as been suggested, that undermines the ability to have a consensual approach. I think while we may feel powerless in the face of these huge events, there is, of course, action that we can take as individuals, as Alec Cole-Hamilton has mentioned. For my part, I did take in a Ukrainian family. I thought I would end up with an older gentleman, too old to serve in the war, but in fact ended up with a family, two children and a dog, and had them in my home for a number of months this year. But we managed over the period of that time to find both new accommodation and employment for them, which is very commendable. I know also that in school the children of the family received one-to-one English lessons, which was necessary, and also the family themselves undertook language lessons, and it was interesting to have them come back and ask me about the meanings of the words like drukit, drich, both of which they seemed to master, but could not get quite the meaning of nae bother until we explained it. But they were given some Scots language teaching as well. In October last year, in my constituency, the Ukrainian refugees organised a fair as part of their celebrations of Ukrainian Cossack Day. And though I can't speak for every Ukrainian refugee in Scotland, it's my view that most of them have received a very warm Scottish welcome, with Scotland taking in 26,200 displaced Ukrainians, the most of any UK nation. I think that is worthy of comment and commendation. However, for those who choose to continue to make Scotland their home, we must turn that into a warm Scottish future. And the policy position paper recognises the need to work across the different layers of government. Many members have mentioned Edinburgh. In my own area, a small council, Clackmannshire Council, won an award last year for its refugee integration scheme. So this is the right approach to take. And the same approach now needs to be taken by the UK government. And they have to give clarity on what happens when the three-year visa period available to Ukrainian refugees comes to an end. Paul O'Kane mentioned this, but if I could just mention a text I got from my constituent, now rehoused, who has the opportunity to move into social housing. Paul O'Kane rightly said we should hear the voices of Ukrainians. And he mentions that they went last week to view social housing that was offered to them, that was half the price of the accommodation they're currently in. But they have to say when they accept it within a day. It's a three-bedroom, three-floor monthly a monthly fee for half of what they currently pay. But it requires complete renovation, painting and carpeting on the floor. And all this work must be done before they can give them the 15 months before the rent freeze starts. They also have to buy a freezer, washing machine and cooking stove, etc. Now, this is difficult in any event, but to do this without knowing whether in a year's time you're still going to have the right to stay in the country is virtually impossible. And the same inhibition lies on the Scottish Government. How can they be asked to make long-term plans if you do not have the security of those that are currently here having the right to stay? The reassurance to understand the trauma they've gone through in the first place and to compound that trauma by not letting them know that they'll be safe to stay here if that's what they require and want to do. The uncertainty, I know, is causing distress for Ukrainians. It's preventing local authorities and third sector organisations like Forth Valley Welcome in my constituency from adequately planning services, as you don't know how long people will be able to stay in Scotland, or if there's a risk of displaced people being made destitute under UK rules. So I would urge the UK Government to step up to support Ukrainian refugees, as the people of Scotland have done. And, colleagues, by supporting this motion, we can show that Scotland and all the political parties in it remain committed to Ukrainian independence and supporting Ukrainian lives, whether they are here in Scotland or in Ukraine. So I'd urge everyone to support the motion in the Cabinet Secretary's name.
Thank you very much, Mr Brown. Just to advise the Chamber, the time we had in hand has pretty much been exhausted, so I'd be grateful if members could stick to their speaking time allocations. I call Sharon Dowie to be followed by Claire Adamson, up to 4 minutes. Ms Dowie.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Christmas is the perfect time to have this debate because it reminds us just how much Ukrainian people's lives have been upturned by Vladimir Putin's war in Ukraine. Russia's illegal invasion forced families from their homes and wrecked hundreds of thousands of innocent lives. It's hard enough for most of us to imagine having to hastily flee our homes, even temporarily at Christmas. But for the brave people of Ukraine, this is the reality all year round. Their Christmases are not the same, but neither are their Mondays or Tuesdays. Every single day, they suffer the terrible consequences of Putin's war. But Ukrainians have approached this war with admirable defiance. They've been an inspiration not only in the defence of their homeland, but in the way they have settled and continued their lives. The numbers are stark, but they don't truly do justice to the scale of what has happened. There are 8 million Ukrainian refugees across European countries. Almost 250,000 visas have been issued to Ukrainians by the UK government. More than 26,000 Ukrainian refugees have arrived in Scotland alone. I want to applaud all of those Ukrainians for coming to our country and becoming a very welcome part of our communities. None of us can really say how we would handle a terrible situation like this if we found ourselves in that position, but I would hope that we would approach it with the same strength of character that the Ukrainians have. Today, I also want to applaud the generosity and kindness of Scottish and British people who have welcomed Ukrainians. It's been incredible to see so many people take Ukrainian families into their own homes, including those in the chamber. They've been made to feel safe and included because of the compassion of local people. In South Ayrshire, approximately 350 Ukrainians have come to live across around 160 households, while in East Ayrshire, there are currently 225 Ukrainians living across 86 households. And I also want to thank the many local groups and charities who've also helped, from schools to churches to local businesses. They've all pulled together to help wherever they can. Bernardo's have also done an incredible job to help support those who've come here. They provide regular emotional support and safe spaces for young people and parents to help understand the trauma they've gone through. It's an excellent resource because, as Bernardo's have noted, many families displaced from Ukraine find this difficult within their own support networks, where others are also in distress. One quote from a Ukrainian parent sums up the work Bernardo's has done. He said, "I'm so happy you helped me to settle. You're my biggest angel in Scotland. I appreciate everything you did for me and my family." We can be proud of our country's actions, both at home in welcoming Ukrainians and on the front line of this war. The UK has stepped up with a tremendous amount of support for ordinary Ukrainian people in need of aid, and with vast resources to help Ukraine to fight Vladimir Putin's invasion. Our country has done a lot on so many fronts for Ukraine, but there are still problems that need to be addressed for Ukrainian people to rebuild their lives here in Scotland. The SNP government must act to address the plight of 7,500 Ukrainian refugees stuck in temporary accommodation. That is part of a wider housing crisis in Scotland, but we cannot let these people down who have already endured such hardship. I hope today that the Government will consider and reflect on how they can urgently provide Ukrainian families with the level of housing support that they deserve. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. I now call Claire Adamson to be followed by Paul Sweeney. Up to 4 minutes, Ms Adamson.
Interest as a member of the cross-party group on Ukraine, and welcome the comments about Colin Beattie and setting that up in the Parliament. I am also the MSP for Motherwell and Wishaw, and we have a project there in North Lanarkshire that has seen over 80 families come to my constituency to be welcomed into our community, and commend the work North Lanarkshire did, where they were provided not only with accommodation but fully furnished starter packs, everything they would need in terms of white goods and the support services there, as they took over two towers that were earmarked to be demolished by the council but have come back into use for the Ukrainian families, and they are very, very welcome there. Of course, thousands of people have lost their lives and many more their livelihoods because of the Russian military assault. But Putin isn't just about occupation. He is intent on destroying Ukrainian culture, Ukrainian identity and the Ukrainian language to eradicate exactly what it means to be Ukrainian. Critical infrastructure has been razed, and make no mistake, this is cultural imperialism. Theatres, places of worship, amenities for public good have been levelled by Russian shelling. Museums have been emptied of priceless treasures, and the invasion is rooted in centuries of persecution. The Ukrainian language and culture have been oppressed throughout history. In the early 18th century, Peter I sought to eliminate the idea of a separate Ukrainian state, issuing a decree against the use of Ukrainian in religious texts and in books. Peter II ordered the rewriting of the state regulations into Russian. Under Catherine II, churches across the Russian Empire were ordered to conduct services in Russian. And following the end of the Russian Empire, Ukraine was absorbed into the Soviet Union. The Stalinist purges saw political dissidents, artists, writers and scientists summarily sentenced and executed. And Ukrainian culture was cynically positioned as rural and outdated, and attempts to assert independence were violently quashed. Only a few short weeks ago, in this chamber, we were debating the horrors of the Holodomor. And some people still deny what happened during that dark period, but we cannot deny it, and we should not deny what is happening today. This invasion draws from a legacy of imperial subjugation which seeks to erase Ukrainians. In 2021, the Russian leader published an article claiming Ukraine has never existed and that Ukrainians and Russians are one people, one whole. And Putin's supporters have been radicalised by imperialist ideals of the historical predecessors. Ideals, which is important to note, are opposed vociferously by swathes of the Russian population. After the invasion in 2022, troops began confiscating and destroying Ukrainian history and fiction books amidst an bombardment of modern artillery, and grim historical goals remained the same. In August 2022, I was honoured to host a cultural leadership dialogue at this Parliament with the Edinburgh International Culture Summit and the Ukrainian Institute. We brought together political and cultural leaders from countries who share a strong interest in strengthening Ukraine's international standing and supporting Ukrainian culture. Colleagues, if these institutions, if Ukraine is to continue, we must reach now and do everything we can do to support the Ukrainian people and their culture at this time. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Ms Adamson. I now call Paul Sweeney to be followed by Ben McPherson. Up to 4 minutes, Mr Sweeney.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. In February 2022, when Vladimir Putin launched his brutal all-out invasion of Ukraine, the worst escalation in the Russo-Ukrainian war since it began in 2014, Scotland rightly stood in solidarity with the Ukrainian people. Scots opened their doors in droves and welcomed displaced Ukrainians into their own homes. It is a testament to the generosity and warmth of Scots that as of October this year, 25,701 displaced people arrived in the UK with a Scottish sponsor. Many Ukrainian refugees were also housed on board ferries and cruise ships. like the motor ship Ambition that was berthed at the King George V dock in Glasgow, and also in hotel rooms up and down the country. As the war continues and emergency measures shift to longer-term thinking about how we supply safe and appropriate accommodation, it is right that we think about how we best settle and integrate Ukrainians in Scotland, keeping a keen eye on reducing homelessness, because as Ukrainians are four times more likely to find themselves homeless than the rest of the population. Is happy to give way.
Cabinet Secretary.
Thanks. In the desperate attempt to try and be consensual, I think this quote about the four times is actually a UK figure. It's not really what we see replicated happening here in Scotland. So I'm not saying there's not an issue and we need to challenge it, but I would have some caution about that figure because I don't think that actually replicates what's actually happening across Scotland rather than the UK.
Paul Sweeney, I can give you some of that time back.
Well, of course, as my colleague, the Member for West Scotland, intimated that we rely on the Red Cross for supplying that briefing of that information. If the Minister would like to furnish us with equivalent Scottish-specific data in due course, that would be welcome, so we have clarity on that relative position in Scotland. What I would also highlight is that it is a shame that the Ukrainian resettlement team in Glasgow, where we have the highest number of Ukrainians settled, are winding down their operations when their work is arguably more important than ever. In a move that the GMB trade union has called misguided, the resettlement team have been told that from the 15th of January they will be merging with the General Asylum and Refugee team. The resettlement team in Glasgow are working in the specific circumstances of Ukrainians to ensure a smooth transition from hotel accommodation, and critically the team are dealing with a variety of complex pastoral issues that often comes with the trauma of war. Part of the plan has to be, surely, properly funded asylum and refugee services, and these cuts to the provision in Glasgow will significantly harm the efforts to resettle and integrate Ukrainians in the city. Glasgow recently became the second city in Scotland to declare a housing emergency. With years of chronic underfunding in social housing supply, it is imperative that the declaration of a housing emergency by Glasgow leads to a swift house building plan. Therefore, it was disappointing to hear just a few minutes ago in the budget statement that the government has announced effectively a 32% cut to capital funding of housing over the last 2 years in cash terms, but then when compounded with a 15% rise in construction costs in 2022 and a 25% rise in costs in 2021. That is a severe and significant erosion in purchasing power for housing supply in this country, one that is completely unacceptable. And when set against the £100 million contract for cruise ship hire, for example, it highlights a lack of long-term planning and financial management that allows for the best effect and best utilisation of public funds for the best outcomes for the people we're trying to help. I was particularly alarmed, for example, by the plan at Balmore Road in Glasgow's Postle Park district, where homes that were originally destined for demolition, 1930s tenement homes, with the sitting tenants transferred to other housing stock, were suddenly saved and funds became available to renovate them to provide housing for Ukrainian refugees. Now, well,
Member cannot give way. He's beginning to wind up.
Yeah, I'm afraid I don't have time to raise that point in detail with the member for Springburn Muirhill. But I would say that it is a fine example of the haphazard approach to planning this, because it is right and proper that whilst capital is invested to transform void properties, the Balmore Road example shows that it risks coming at the expense of community cohesion, with a lot of complaints raised locally about this if it's not done properly. We will only get resettlement right if we increase housing stock at pace, bringing unused properties back into use and building new social housing across the country. We owe it to the Ukrainian people that have fled the most tragic of circumstances to ensure that they do not end up without a roof over their head, and we do it in the most constructive and cohesive way possible.
Thank you, Mr. Sweeney. I now call Ben McPherson to be followed by Maggie Chapman. Up to 4 minutes, Mr. McPherson.
Signing off, sir. The war in Ukraine continues to shock, upset and worry us, and we continue to feel and share great admiration for the people of Ukraine as they continue to fight for democracy and for the rule of law, for their culture and for their country. Their struggle is our struggle, and we stand with them. And in that spirit, the Scottish people and the Scottish Government and the UK Government and all the authorities involved, and particularly I pay tribute to the City of Edinburgh Council here, are due a huge amount of praise and respect for the fact that over 26,000 displaced Ukrainians have come here and been able to establish their lives here. As the Cabinet Secretary did, I pay tribute to the civil service in this regard, and particularly to two officials who I had the privilege of working with, Alison and Miriam, and the remarkable job that they did. And particularly with regard to the MS Victoria ship that was docked in Leith in my constituency for around a year, I pay tribute to the matching teams, so not just the Scottish Government, but also City of Edinburgh Council, and to Alistair that Alex Cole-Hamilton mentioned. All of these individuals and their colleagues have rightly won awards for their work, and we should respect them and admire them for that commitment and that achievement. The MS Victoria ship in Leith meant that my constituency played a significant role in welcoming those 26,000 displaced Ukrainians to our communities. And I had the privilege of meeting with many on board, as well as with local organisations and national organisations assisting those individuals to settle here, including one-parent families. And I have to say that the feedback I received from our Ukrainian Scots here was very positive about the welcome they'd received, about the support that they'd been given, and about the enabling of them being able to contribute to our society, our shared society. They established support networks. They became very established in a number of schools, including particularly Victoria Primary School, as Miles Briggs mentioned. And many of them, of course, also took up employment here in Edinburgh and contributed a lot and continue to do so. As the ship disembarked, it did present challenge, and I'm grateful to the Cabinet Secretary for the Government's engagement with me and my office through that process. Many did have to move out of Edinburgh, some reluctantly, and I think that is a point of consideration going forward. The work that went in to converting the houses that were unused into use, including here in Edinburgh, that 1,201 houses includes many here in Edinburgh. That £24 million made a difference here in Edinburgh. But I think the situation did emphasise something that I do talk about regularly in this Parliament, which is the particular challenge of housing that we have in the capital, and that very welcome £550 million in the next financial year for the affordable housing supply programme. If any of that can be given strategic prioritisation in Edinburgh, that would make a difference for everyone here. I declare an interest as a member of the cross-party group, and we will look to work with the government on the Ukraine longer-term resettlement fund and the utilisation of that, and I look forward to it. And I would just like to close, Presiding Officer, with some words from Andrei Klusly, the Ukrainian consul in Edinburgh, which is in my constituency. He said, Scotland's commitment to supporting Ukrainian citizens rather in response to Russia's aggression against Ukraine serves as a powerful symbol of solidarity. By offering comprehensive assistance, Scotland stands unwaveringly with the people of Ukraine, extending a message of hope and unity. The actions of the Scottish Government and its partners not only provide immediate relief, but also send a powerful message to the world about the importance of coming together to support and protect vulnerable populations during times of Russia's war against Ukraine. The people of Scotland and the Scottish Government deserve our deepest gratitude for their unwavering support during this tumultuous period in Ukraine. Let's keep supporting as best we can.
Thank you. I now call Maggie Chapman to be followed by Marie McNair. Up to 4 minutes, Ms. Chapman.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Just a week ago, we were here discussing the human rights of asylum seekers in Scotland. Many colleagues highlighted the important contribution that asylum seekers and refugees have made and will continue to make to our communities. We know that those who fled Russia's illegal invasion of Ukraine and sought sanctuary and refuge here in Scotland have already made valuable contributions to our communities, our culture and our country. We should be proud that Scotland has stood resolutely with Ukrainians fleeing war. We should be proud that over 25,000 displaced Ukrainians have been supported here. And we should be proud that we opened our hearts and homes to so many people in perhaps the greatest humanitarian protection we have ever undertaken. I am very grateful to COSLA, individual local authorities, the Scottish Refugee Council and others in the third sector that have worked together over the last 21 months and also in developing a warm Scots future. Strategic planning and its implementation are everyone's responsibility. We talk about our tradition of hospitality and welcome, of Scotland being a nation of immigrants. But this tradition, this culture, is clearly under threat, given the actions, legislation and approach taken by the UK government so desperate to undermine us. So we must keep doing things differently here. And while we applaud the generosity of people opening their homes and families to those in need, this issue is too important to leave to individual actions alone. A warm Scots future represents a shift to looking ahead, focused on the integration of Ukrainian refugees into all aspects of Scottish life. We want them to be able to play active roles in communities across Scotland and have the opportunity to rebuild their lives and fulfil their potential in work and education. The strategy highlights the importance of education and that it must be accessible for people of all ages, from childcare provision to postgraduate degrees. We need a warm Scots future in spirit, but in reality too. The homes we provide need to be literally warm in winter, not too hot in summer. Quality housing is a key foundation for a thriving future, as others have highlighted. And I hope we can build on schemes like Aberdeen City Council's use of the Ukraine Longer Term Resettlement Fund to bring up to 500 homes back into use across the city. And of course, when these homes are no longer needed by Ukrainians, they'll be retained as part of the city's social housing stock for others in need. Our response to the war in Ukraine showed our capacity for imagination, empathy, and solidarity. People faced experiences beyond our comprehension, and we pulled together. We have collectively learned about trauma, about community building, about the strength of the bonds of our shared humanity. And we are going to need to build on all of these and more over the coming years, as we will see increasing international crises, wars over territory and scarce resources, natural disasters, climate catastrophe. What we have learned in the last 2 years can help us facilitate deep and lasting support for Ukrainians and, I hope, all others who need sanctuary and refuge. Because our commitment to a shared humanity must be for all people, not just those some deem worthy. And, of course, the work we do here will be complemented by work on the international stage, peacemaking, mitigation and adaptation to climate change, reconstruction based not on corporate enrichment, but on grassroots participation and democracy. We must grasp this opportunity to show feminist foreign policy in action. So in conclusion, Presiding Officer, we should be proud of what we have done in Scotland, but we must always strive to do more, acutely aware of wars, oppression, and climate effects across the world, and the people affected, equally in need of sanctuary, able to contribute to Scotland's future. Thank you.
Thank you. I am going to have to encourage members again to stick to their speaking allocations. Marie McNair to be followed by Fulton McGregor. Up to 4 minutes, Ms McNair.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm pleased to speak in this debate in support of the Scottish Government's strategy to help Ukrainians living in Scotland settle in communities and gain longer-term housing. Since the invasion of Ukraine, Scotland has offered sanctuary to over 26,000 people from Ukraine who have arrived with a Scottish sponsor, more than 20,500 of them through the Super Sponsor Scheme. In the West Dumbartonshire part of my constituency, 241 Ukrainians have settled, including 209 in council-owned homes. The local council are developing proposals to make another 60 properties available for Ukrainians in 2024. The Scottish Government has made clear they are following a different path to the UK Government when it comes to refugees, one that treats them with compassion, kindness and dignity. These are the values of so many Scots across our country, and it's been truly heartwarming to witness communities across Scotland welcome Ukrainians with open arms. In my hometown of Claybank, I've witnessed this from my own eyes. Ukrainian refugees have not just been welcomed in, but they've been treated as equals and shown they have a future in our community. Oco-Patrick Food Parcels, Community Hub and Chatty Cafe, run by Maureen Cummings and our amazing team, are a great example of this. In 2022, Maureen and her team decided to make up a food parcel for a young Ukrainian family living in a hotel in West Dumbartonshire. And while this was so welcome, the family had no appliances to cook meals in the hotel and were desperate to make a home-cooked meal. So the Okopatrick food parcel team put together a list of ingredients needed to make a traditional Ukrainian meal, sourced the food, and then opened their chatty cafe kitchen to the family to cook. And since this time, the team have held Ukrainian family days, which are growing every month, and I've seen over 30 parents and children from Ukraine get together for food, fun, and a chance to bond with people from back home. The mother of the young family has even volunteered in the food bank and helped translate for Ukrainian families to make sure they receive food too. And on Mother's Day this year, the team held a special event for Ukrainian families to come together, share food, gifts, chat, and have a sing-song and actually get other people to learn Ukrainian songs. It was a great day. And many of them will be really missing their own mothers this year, so it was really a lovely, special moment. The Okopatrick food parcel team have really gone above and beyond to make sure Ukrainians in the community feel not just welcomed, but a real part of the community. They've made clear to the community that refugees will be welcomed in Clydebank and will be shown they have a future there. They're an equal part of our community. I will always be truly in awe of their team, and my sincere thanks go to Maureen and all the amazing staff and volunteers. Their selflessness is really unmatched, and the Okopatrick food parcel team example is just one of many, but it shows how local communities have come together to support those in need. The Scottish Government's new strategy will build upon the initial kindness and compassion shown by residents and work to ensure Ukrainian residents can settle in the community and in long-term accommodation. Scotland acted swiftly at a time of legal invasion of Ukraine, so it's only right that we lead the way in giving Ukrainian people a positive future here. With a strong community spirit and the Scottish Government funding, our local Ukrainian residents will be able to thrive and have a bright future in Scotland. That's the way it should be, a compassionate Scotland there for everyone. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms McNair. And now the final speaker in the open debate, Fulton McGregor, up to 4 minutes. Mr McGregor.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. In recent years, we have sadly witnessed numerous international crises which have displaced millions globally. The situation in Afghanistan, the ongoing crisis in the Middle East, and, of course, the topic of today's debate, the illegal Russian war against Ukraine. It is now estimated that the conflict has pushed 6.3 million people out of Ukraine, which is the largest displacement of people Europe has seen since World War II. And to put that figure into perspective, that is almost 1 million more people displaced than the entire population of Scotland. This chamber has consistently been united in voicing our support and solidarity in standing alongside our European neighbours for democracy, human rights and the rule of law at home and abroad. And I'm proud to say, as others have already said today, that Scotland has gone above and beyond in offering sanctuary and support to those fleeing the conflict. More than 26,000 Ukrainians are now based in Scotland, and although I dearly wish that circumstances that forced so many Ukrainians to come to Scotland had never transpired, it is indicative of our welcoming nature that Scotland have supported the most refugees per capita across the UK nations. Indeed, within my constituency of Coatbridge and Crichton, that so many Ukrainians now have a base. Highcoats Tower in Coatbridge is currently home to nearly 150 Ukrainian families. And I must give special mention to the North Lancashire Council Resettlement Service, who have done and continue to do an outstanding job in integrating, supporting and welcoming those Ukrainians who are presently based in North Lancashire, and also include Claire Adamson's constituency as well. Last April, I held a Welcome to Coatbridge event which connected new arrivals with a host of businesses, churches and community groups in the area. And I can see the presiding officer's really tough in time, so I was intending to name them, but I'm now not going to, but I'd like to thank each and every one of them. I do feel it was a successful event. We heard that back from the Ukrainians that attended. I know it helped them to integrate into the community. But I do want to thank my office team in setting up the event. And I've got a surprise visit from one of my office today in the gallery, Donna Simpson. So I want to put on record here a wee surprise back to her. A thank you to her and all the team for the work they do and continue to do on my behalf supporting Ukrainian refugees in Coatbridge. But the focus that I mentioned on integration is important because it's now almost 2 years since Vladimir Putin's devastating actions. While Scotland has done well at providing emergency accommodation in this dreadful context, we must now look to ensure that those fleeing the war in Ukraine are supported to rebuild their lives in Scotland should they wish to. The War on Scots Future strategy seeks to do this by providing funding to help provide language lessons, employment services, mental health support and housing support. And I want to reiterate that Scotland can be home for every Ukrainian living here for as long as they need and want it to be. And during a recent meeting here in Holyrood with the North Lancashire Council Resettlement Service and a number of Ukrainian refugees living in North Lancashire, the topics of visas was raised as a key concern amongst those Ukrainians, but all Ukrainians in Scotland. And although we know this chamber cannot pass legislation regarding asylum seekers, refugees and visas, it is imperative that we continue to press the UK Government on giving clarity to those who are facing such uncertainty as their current three-year visas draw to a close. This uncertainty is not only leaving Ukrainians in stasis, but services, local authorities and the third sector partners in limbo too, as they seek to plan for the future to best support those who have come here. So, in summing up, I'm wondering if the Minister could outline what discussions she has had and will have with the UK Government on this issue and getting some clarity on the matter for those who are affected. I know that it will be deeply appreciated by my constituents, amongst others. Presiding Officer, I'll therefore close by once again thanking all those in the community across my constituency and across Scotland who have made such an effort in sheltering those fleeing from the Ukrainian conflict. I urge the UK Government to provide clarity and security for those who have come here.
Thank you, Mr McGregor. Thank you. I'm now going to move to the wind-up speeches. I call first Faisal Chowdhury. Up to 5 minutes, please.
Thank you. Deputy Presiding Officer, this debate today is indeed an opportunity for us all to reaffirm our solidarity with people of Ukraine. And it gives me a great honour to close on behalf of the Labour Party. For displaced people from Ukraine in Scotland, a concrete solution has been long awaited. In the wake of Russia's invasion of Ukraine almost 2 years ago, the SNP government promised a warm Scottish welcome for those displaced. As Kit Brown pointed out, Scotland has been able to host 20% of Ukrainians in the UK. Both ordinary Scot and public service providers have pulled out all the stops and given displaced Ukrainians a very warm welcome and vital support. Not to mention organisations such as the Scottish Refugee Council, who have been working flat out to help the refugees find housing in the middle of housing crisis. We must now support the amazing actions of Scot and local authorities with a long-term solid solution which allows Ukrainian refugees fair access to housing, education and healthcare. This plan must remain in place for all those who may be still to come as Putin's unlawful war in Ukraine continues. As the Cabinet Secretary pointed out, the super sponsor scheme saw many ordinary Scots step up and house those most in need in the aftermath of Russia's invasion. As Alex Cole Hamilton mentioned, this was an excellent scheme which saw many Scots open their homes to displaced people from Ukraine. But it was not a permanent solution. We must remember that it was the SNP that temporarily housed Ukrainian refugees in boats in both Edinburgh and Glasgow, because it had no prepared anywhere else from them to stay. Those housed, I'm tight for time. I'll take your intervention.
Ben McPherson, briefly.
Would Mr Chowdhury acknowledge that in many, many cases, arguably the majority of feedback from the Ukrainian community in the Lothian region that he represents, that those who were on the MS Victoria in Leith had a very positive experience and spoke very positively about how they were looked after and supported during that period?
Faisal Chowdhury, and I can't give you that time back.
Thank you very much. I appreciate your intervention, and I had the privilege of visiting both of the boats, the one in Leith and the one in Glasgow. And yes, we do have positive response, but we are talking for long-term solution. As I was coming to my... my speeches, those housed on the boat had begun to build lives where they were docked. They built a relationship, sent their children to local schools, and got to know the areas. Of course, the lease of the boats had to come to an end, and the refugees housed there were once again moved to a new place and had to begin again. This was due to lack of long-term plan. Deputy Presiding Officer, Paul Kane and my colleague Paul Sweeney highlighted that Ukrainians are four times more likely to find themselves facing homelessness than the wider population. This is in the middle of a housing emergency across Scotland, where homelessness reaches close to 5,000 households in a night in Edinburgh alone. And I appreciate Cabinet Secretary's intervention that there could be a different data in Scotland, which I will await for. Mild Briggs rightly pointed out that sustainable solutions are urgently needed to reduce the impact of this on Ukrainian and everyone in Scotland. A long-term concrete plan is a long overdue. The war in the Ukraine is not over. And as long as Putin's illegal war continues, Scotland must be both welcoming to the prepared for refugees from Ukraine coming to Scotland. The Cabinet Secretary spoke of the need to support the integration of Ukrainians for as long as they want to call Scotland their home. For true integration, the Scottish Government must ensure that the workable plan is implemented now to allow for Ukrainian refugees to access long-term assistance.
Thank you, Mr. Chowdhury. Thank you, Mr. Chowdhury. We now need to move to next speaker, Megan Gallagher, up to 6 minutes. Ms. Gallagher.
We are standing strong. We have deep roots. We can't be blown over. This is the place where we are grounded. These words will stay with me for a long time, Presiding Officer, and they will stay with me because of a talented Ukrainian artist, Tatiana Hearn. I had the pleasure of meeting Tatiana at the Moira Anderson Foundation in Airdrie when I was invited alongside local MSPs to see the mural that she hand-painted for them. When thinking about a mural, I thought this would be a section of wall, not a 15-metre corridor that had been completely transformed into a beautiful woodland scene that creates a sense of calm and tranquility. The mural, now entitled Spirit of the Forest, creates a corridor of hope for children and adults affected by childhood sexual abuse. The quote I just mentioned was written across the top of the woodland scene, and I realised at that point that the quote meant just as much to Tatiana as it does to the many people who receive vital support at the foundation. Because Ukrainian people are strong, they care deeply about their country, and they won't be broken by Putin's illegal war that he has inflicted on the people of Ukraine. That's why today's debate is important, Presiding Officer. We can't lose sight of the horrors of this war, and this was highlighted by Miles Briggs and others during their contributions this afternoon. 6 million people have been displaced, 209,000 have come to the UK, and more than 26,000 Ukrainian refugees have arrived in Scotland since the illegal war began. And it is right that we reflect on the support that has been offered so that we can continue to offer a safe place for Ukrainian families to live, learn and work. Many, like Tatiana, have embedded themselves into communities and have already made such an impact, helping and supporting others and using their skills and talents. Sharon Dowie reiterated this because she applauded families from Ukraine who have come over to Scotland. Alex Cole-Hamilton and Keith Brown reminded the Chamber that they have opened their own homes when the war began through the sponsorship scheme, helped them get the support they need, and of course passed on the local lingo of "nae bother". But we know that the Ukrainian refugee scheme has had its challenges, and it is important that we continue to do more for as long as our friends intend to stay here with us. The Cabinet Secretary mentioned the collegiate working between local governments, charities and third-party organisations, and the support that has been implemented to ensure those who have arrived from Ukraine have access to services including healthcare and education. We need to continue to look at the needs of our friends during their time here, and I do welcome the Cabinet Secretary's intention to look at the real-life experiences of Ukrainian refugees, especially when dealing with the trauma of war and displacement. Miles Briggs spoke about schools and paid tribute to children who have forged relationships that will create many lasting friendships. He also raised an amendment today that raises concerns over current housing issues, specifically refugees stuck in temporary accommodation. There needs to be a focus on this, and although that I appreciate that this does expand outside of the Cabinet Secretary's brief, this must be a focus for government to drive down the housing waiting lists, but to also make sure that we have good, affordable homes. Paul O'Kane raised the strength of the cross-party group on Ukraine that allows for MSPs to call for more support and to ensure that we are getting it right for those who have been displaced. The Labour amendment, as it says, seeks to add to the motion as Scots, the length and breadth of the country, rose to the challenge and welcomed Ukrainians into their homes. We will be supporting the Labour amendment at decision time. Presiding officer, it has been said many times today, as we approach Christmas, we must remember those who will be spending this time apart from their families because of the ongoing wars and conflict that we have at present. And as always, my thoughts are with all innocent people caught up in these conflicts. And that's why I'll close by once again, reiterating the Scottish Conservative support for the people of Ukraine. And we will continue to work cross-party to ensure Scotland remains welcoming and that we offer a home for as long as they need. We will be voting for the Scottish Government and Labour motion and amendments tonight. And as Paul O'Kane said at the beginning of his speech, Parliament is at its best when we stand together. So I ask the Scottish Government for a collegiate approach this evening too. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Callaghan. I now call Emma Roddick to respond to the debate. Minister, up to 8 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I welcome the general consensus in this debate, as well as the opportunity to share what we have been doing to successfully welcome almost 26,300 Ukrainians to Scotland. Of course, that's more per head of population than anywhere else in the UK. And that has been welcomed by Ukrainians. As Ben McPherson stated, the Ukrainian consul himself has called our demonstration of support a strong message to the rest of the world about how to welcome those in need of refuge. And Miles Briggs was right to say that we need to give proper consideration to concerns that Ukrainians living in Scotland have. And that's exactly what we intend to do and why the Cabinet Secretary and I both engage frequently with Ukrainians in Scotland and those who support them. And that's very important because the responses are often surprising. While you can be sure that employability questions will come up, I've had Ukrainians give feedback that I did not expect on everything from being concerned that particularly younger kids in school are doing so well with English that their parents are worried they're going to lose Ukrainian, to enjoying the rain so much that they wish it would come more frequently. And I think it's important that we pick up on issues with our programme that we can sort out and to support Ukrainians not just to integrate into Scotland but to keep their Ukrainian culture and language alive while they're here so that those who wish to can return and help to rebuild the country after they win the war. So Claire Adamson was right to focus on the destruction of culture, and I'm glad that there was a speech in this debate with time given to that issue. That fear that people will forget Ukrainian, that they'll forget how to play the bandura, or that we won't see people wear vashivankas is very real. And I enjoyed a demonstration of what an excellent instrument the bandura is at an event celebrating Ukrainian Independence Day this year in Glasgow. Just on Saturday, I was introduced to a homemade Kiev cake. Ukrainians have so much to be proud of, and I hope that they're able to protect their culture and keep it alive while they call Scotland their home. And I want to recognise that there is a strong voice here across the Scottish Parliament for support, and I recognise that many members take a special interest in supporting Ukrainians, whether it's contributing to debates like this, joining the new CPG, or of course the work of the Constitution Europe External Affairs and Culture Committee, which I know, having sat in front of them last week, have been working hard to scrutinise the work that is going on. Our priorities for supporting displaced Ukrainians must be led by the lived experience of Ukrainians, and that's why we must all continue to listen. Our Warm Scots Welcome position paper commits us to that and itself reflects the input of Ukrainians who told us what their priorities were moving forward. I'll give way.
Alex Cole Hamilton.
I'm very grateful for the Minister giving way. One of the lived experiences of some of our Ukrainian guests is their inability to access employment opportunities or indeed housing opportunities because they don't have the mobility to do so. Would the Minister offer some reflections on my remarks about the discretionary travel scheme and whether the Scottish Government will make that available to our Ukrainian guests?
Minister.
Yes, I'm going to come on specifically to the concessionary travel point, but I would point out that when Ukrainians came to Scotland, we opened up social security to them. They have the right to work. So in terms of mobility, we are doing everything within our power to ensure that they have those opportunities to support themselves and their families. On Saturday, I was welcomed by Ukrainians and those who support them in Inverness at the Highlands for Ukraine Hub. And I spoke with people about what's been helpful to them in terms of support, events, opportunities to gather. And what came across so clearly was the strength of spirit and determination amongst the displaced Ukrainians making their home in the Highlands in Inverness and Aviemore, as well as that widespread will to help them from the Highland community, from individuals who have become hosts to trucks being filled with aid to send to Eastern Europe and the local Rotary Club organising fun and lively acts of kindness, including sleigh rides and contributing to collections for Ukraine. As with all engagement with the Ukrainian community recently, the issue of visas did come up. People are worried, and I think we can all understand the anxiety for people who are trying to make their lives here, not knowing how long they will be allowed to stay, having escaped a war ongoing in Ukraine, that distress that Keith Brown described. But this is also having a wider impact on their ability to integrate because it's a matter of concern for their landlords, for employers, for lenders, and anyone else who wants to see that certainty of a secure migration status. So to answer Fulton McGregor on his question about pressing the UK government, I have done so on many occasions, most recently at a Ukraine trilateral along with Minister Hutt from the Welsh government. So there is a joint effort ongoing to get that clarity for Ukrainians living in Scotland and across the UK, and I hope that the UK government will provide that clarity as soon as possible. In the meantime, as the Cabinet Secretary has already assured the Chamber, we will continue to engage with our valued partners to support displaced people from Ukraine as best we can within the circumstances. And I don't want to stop short of celebrating that work that is being carried out because, again, as the Cabinet Secretary noted, our team in the Scottish Government has been nationally recognised for the work that has been done on the Warm Scottish Welcome. And we, of course, welcomed over 3,000 people to MS Victoria and Ambition, the former of which I had the opportunity to visit and speak with residents. Now, this temporary accommodation, which was kitted out to a high standard with services on board, served its purpose of providing that emergency short-term accommodation before those on board were supported fully through ourselves, local authority, partners, to find long-term accommodation. And I would point out that, you know, there were children drawing pictures of the boat, calling it home, and Ukrainians asking if we could just keep it there forever. So positive was their experience of life on board. But we recognise that temporary accommodation is exactly that, and encouraged people, supported people, to find that long-term suitable accommodation. Our partners, the Association of Ukrainians in Great Britain, the Scottish Refugee Council, and those local authorities who have gone above and beyond, have ensured that the experience from stepping off the plane to getting into long-term accommodation is that of Scotland being a welcoming country which supports Ukraine, is glad to have Ukrainians here to stay, and wants to help them as much as possible. And like Maggie Chapman, I want to thank everyone involved, including the many Ukrainians who now volunteer to ensure that others get that same warm welcome for their hard work. To Alex Cole Hamilton's point about concessionary travel, I think we have to be clear here about the difference between rights of asylum seekers and rights of displaced people from Ukraine. We are looking into how best to provide free bus travel to asylum seekers because asylum seekers are not eligible for social security, nor do they have a right to work. And both of these facts are ones which the Scottish Government opposes. We've consistently called for better support for asylum seekers. We are working to publish a proposal next year for asylum seekers in Scotland to be allowed the right to work. And I see every day the mutual benefits that we and Ukrainians displaced to Scotland get from their right to work. Employers who've recruited Ukrainians often tell us that this was a great move for them in filling their vacancies with people who've been displaced through war, but often very skilled, leaving that work in Ukraine with qualifications and experience that Scotland badly needs. Scotland has been unwavering in its solidarity for Ukraine, and our message today for Ukrainians in Scotland is clear. We continue to stand with you, we continue to welcome you in our communities, and we will continue to support you to build new lives in Scotland. Slava Ukraini.
Thank you. That concludes the debate on From a Warm Scots Welcome to a Warm Scots Future for Ukrainians in Scotland, and it's now time to move on to the next item of business, which is consideration of business motion 11722 in the name of George Adam on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau on changes to the business programme. Any member who wishes to speak against the motion should press their request to speak button now. And I call on George Adam to move the motion.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm moved.
Thank you, Minister. No member has asked to speak against the motion. Therefore, the question is that motion 11722 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thank you. The motion is therefore agreed. And there are three questions to be put as a result of today's business. The first question is that amendment 11696.2 in the name of Miles Briggs, which seeks to amend motion 11696 in the name of Shirley Ann Somerville on From a Warm Scots Welcome to a Warm Scots Future for Ukrainians in Scotland be agreed. Are we all agreed?
No.
The Parliament is not agreed, therefore we'll move to a vote and there'll be a short suspension to allow members to access the digital voting system.